the SMC group. Sorry for that, Dr. Surjit Bhalla, who was former executive director, International Monetary Fund, could not join. So we were expecting
complex
to join.
Sector 24
I think some noise is coming. Okay. We have Dr. Charan Singh. As always, he is very energetic. Member also, he will give thanks also, and he will do companioning of the session. We have with us Ms. Upasana Bhardwaj, Chief Economist, Kotak Mahindra Bank. So we welcome you, Madam. We also welcome Sri Indranil Sen Gupta, Head of Research, CLSA India. So we also welcome you that you always spare time for SOCHAM and eGrow Foundation and for this Shadow Monetary Policy Committee. Thank you much. Also, Sri Abhik Barua, Chief Economist and Executive Vice President, HDFC Bank. We also welcome you, sir. Sri Siddharth Sanyal, Chief Economist and Head Research, Bandhan Bank. As usual, you always for SOCHAM for attending this Shadow Monetary Policy Committee meeting. So thank you very much, sir. And we also have Sri Arun G. Nagarajan, Chief Economist and Communication Manager, Sundaram Mutual Fund. So thank you very much, all the panelists, and welcome once again. Today, as you know, before happening this monetary policy meeting, we have this Shadow Monetary Policy Committee meeting, and we discuss on monetary policy. And we know that Reserve Bank set to have meeting from December 5th to 7th December 2022. So I am of the opinion that repo rate should be increased by 35 basis points during this meeting. My opinion is based on certain factors which can be like this. CPI inflation, which is around so far more than 7% in current August, September, and more than 6% for last 6-7 months. But in time, in months to come, it seems that it will be soft. It will be softening, and by the end of this, this CPI inflation should come down to less than 6%. Moreover, this wholesale price index inflation, which is around 16% in May and June 2022, has also reduced currently at 8%. So this gives a little bit more comfort. And if we talk about growth perspective, the growth indicators, which is economy indicators, which is seen, auto sales are increasing, PMI is better, you can say that certain other factors like durables, consumer durables and non-durables are weakening, these are negative, and exports is also weakening in view of global recession or lessening of the global demand. But still, we feel that RBI, considering good economic indicators like auto sales, GST collection, e-way bill and PMI, continue to indicate healthy recovery. So considering all these, we presumed that RBI should increase the repo rate by 35 basa. Moreover, if you see Fed, Reserve Bank, they are also giving indication that they, in future terms, the repo rate, they will also not increase much as they used in past. So this was a bigger relief to other central banks, including RBI. And moreover, RBI is also said in the last policy that withdrawal of accommodative policy stance. So I can presume that they will switch to neutral policy stance. So thank you very much. I conclude here. Once again, I welcome all the speakers, all the audience sitting here, and Dr. Charan Singh, who is chairing the session. He is very knowledgeable person. I have ever seen. He is always attending this monetary shadow meeting and give his contribution. So over to Dr. Charan Singh. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for giving us the welcome address, as well as sharing with us the industry's perspective and ASSOCHAM's perspective of the rate cut and the stance. To take it forward, the shadow monetary policy would be obviously chaired by Dr. Surjit Bhalla, former executive director at the International Monetary Fund. And he'll be replacing Dr. Arvind Virmani, who was chairing the session until now, since its inception, since the inception of the shadow monetary policy, but has assumed the role of member of NITI-AIU. In this replacement today, Dr. Bhalla couldn't join us, though we tried our best, but he'll be certainly joining us from next time. He's in the transition, and by next cycle, he'll be fully settled and will be joining us. Today's discussion, I intend to take it as forward. I'll give my initial remarks, and then I will move in the sequence of inviting Mr. Indranil Sen Gupta, then Abhik Barua, then Madam Upasana, then Siddharth Sanyal, and then, of course, Arjun. And this is the sequence which we will follow. With that, let me just make a few introductory observations, and then I'll come in at the time of conclusion. First of all, I would like to mention that when we started the shadow monetary policy, we were very clear in our mind that we are providing inputs to the RBI, and the inputs which are coming from, we bring in the industry perspective extensively, as well as an academic perspective to the monetary policy. With that objective, we generally try to come about a week before the main monetary policy. It is exactly in that context that we have scheduled the shadow monetary policy today. To continue with the discussion on shadow monetary policy, my own personal view is that the economy is doing reasonably well. We have just had the data released day before yesterday, which shows that the economy is growing at a rate of 6.3% in quarter two, as compared to 8.4% in quarter two in the previous year. If we take the 6 month data together, the first half, the economy in terms of GDP at constant price is growing around 9.7% compared to 13.7% in the previous year quarter, first half in the previous year. Looking at the components of GDP, it's very heartening to see that all the data that we have in terms of agriculture, which has really been the backbone and sustained the growth process in our country during the COVID, is doing reasonably well. As well as, if you look at the sectors of construction doing well, even the trade, hotels, transport, communication is doing well. Financial, real estate, and professional services are doing well. Public administration, of course, has been doing well. And that, of course, was expected to be constant there. In terms of private final consumption expenditure, the share in GDP has increased from the previous year, as was expected, as in the range of around 58.4% now. Government final consumption expenditure is in the range of around 9%. The fixed capital formation, which has multiplier effect and very helpful in the long run, is in the range of 34.6, up from 33.4 in quarter two of the previous year. Exports are up, to 23.3, but imports have recorded a significant jump to 31.9. Obviously, the pressure is on the CAD, that is clear. If we look at the high frequency data, again, which has been released just 2 days back, the data again is quite encouraging in terms of sale of commercial vehicles, doing good amount, purchase of private vehicles, that means there is good amount of purchasing power. The cargo handled at major seaports has also recorded a significant increase in the quarter two of the current year when compared to the previous year. I will come to the fiscal indicators a bit later, but I must mention here that the export of goods and services, as I just mentioned, are doing well, but imports are a little higher. Now, if we look at the bank deposits in quarter two of the current year around 12.5% vis-a-vis 9.4% in the previous, and aggregate bank credit is in the range of 20% vis-a-vis 6.7% in the previous year. All I'm trying to mention is that the economy is on a steady key and doing well on most of the indicators. If we look at IIP, the mining in April and September, April to September, is also recording good growth. So is manufacturing, so is electricity. In general, if we look at the data, it is 7.0% in the current year compared to 23.8%. So it's in the positive range. The point that I make is that IIP is doing okay. When it comes to data, little granular, in terms of primary goods, capital goods, intermediate goods, infrastructure, consumer durables and consumer non-durables, again, I find the trend is good and the economy is showing up reasonably well. So there is a positivity in the indices in the IIP data. When we look at the core industries, April to September data, in terms of coal, crude oil, natural gas, fertilizer, steel, cement, electricity, refinery, again, the positivity is noticed in most of the sectors except crude and natural gas. In terms of steel and cement, there's quite a bit of strength. So as far as the real sector is concerned, the economy is looking up and therefore is giving very positive signs. The consumer price index, again, released in the middle of November, has shown that there is little worry because the consumer price, both on food and all commodities, is higher than the band which the RBI has set, 4 to 6%. The CPI combined is little higher than the band, 6.77. The food CPI is little higher than that, 8.53. Cereals and of course fuel are showing the, and footwear of course, but cereals and the fuel is showing the pressure as far as the CPI is concerned. When it comes to the wholesale price index, happy to note that it has come down to single digit. According to the data, it's in the range of 8.39%, down from 10.7 in September and 12.48 when big concerns were raised in August. So the all commodities index is around 8.39% as far as in October. As far as WPI is concerned, primary articles is of course around 11, and the fuel is around 23%, but that's expected to come down. As far as WPI food index is concerned, it's in the range of 6.48. Oil prices, fuel is expected to come down, and that is what I think is going to be positive. Looking at the fiscal story seems very encouraging. The GST for the month of November is 1.45 trillion crore, and this I think is a very positive sign. Many times I wonder if this is trying to capture the whole economy, or there is still some part of the economy, which I think is in the unaccounted sector. And therefore, there's potential for GST to increase. The direct tax collections data is again very positive, and the direct tax collections up to November 10 is in the range of 30.7% higher than the gross collections for the corresponding period of last year. And if the net of refunds is taken, even then the growth is around 25.71% higher than in the corresponding period of last year. And this is up to November 10th. This collection is 61% of the total budget estimates of direct taxes. So the direct tax collection is following a certain trend. In terms of the corporate income tax and personal income tax in terms of gross revenue collections, the growth rate for corporate income tax is 22%, while that for the personal income tax is 40.64%. And if we do the refunds, it is still pretty good in the range of 28 and 27%. So that means the fiscal is doing well, and that should mean that the borrowing pattern, which can put pressure on the interest rates, is and should be under control. The unemployment data again reveals, and this is the periodic labor force survey, and July to September is quite comfortable. It's down to 7.2% from April to June, when it was 7.6, and January to March, when it was 8.2, October to December, when it was 8.7, and July to September 2021, when it was 9.8. So this is coming down reasonably well. So employment figures are good. CMI data also juxtaposes with this and doing reasonably well. If we look at the EPFO payroll data, again, about 16.82 lakh net members in the month of September have joined. That's again showing a very positive trend. When looked at globally, the picture again shows that India is doing very, very well. If we look at the projections released in October by the International Monetary Fund, as you know, the growth rates of almost all countries, all developed countries, is looking downwards vis-a-vis 2023. So that means the slowdown is going to continue. As far as developing countries are concerned, again, the slowdown is happening. But in aggregate, if you look at the emerging market and developing countries as a category, the growth rate will hold on to 3.7% in 2023, which is the same as 2022. While in advanced countries, where most of our exports go, our growth rate is coming down very rapidly in 2023. It was 5.2% in 21, 2.4% in 22, and 1.1% in 2023. So almost a recessionary trend coming in sight in these countries. And the growth rate, if you look at the US, is down from 1.6 to 1, and Euro area from 3.1 to 0.5. In Germany, they're in the negative zone for the next year, 2023. In Italy, they're in the negative zone. In France, they're barely 0.7 from 2.5%. As far as the interest rate cycles are concerned globally, we all know that in the Fed Reserve, there is the news as we read it. Some say they may slow down on their incremental, or some say Powell may just keep pushing it and not slow down. As far as ECB is concerned, Madame Lagarde is on the record saying that she is very worried, and she thinks that she will have to continue with the aggressiveness as far as interest rates are concerned. When it comes to Britain, again, the worry is that they are going to be as aggressive on their interest rates. In Australia, they have been increasing rapidly, and maybe there'll be a little slowdown. And in Brazil, again, the thought is, will they slow down or will they increase it? They have done it 12 straight increases in a row, and then they held it. They are around 13.75%, so quite high as far as Brazil is concerned. So with this scenario, which is unfolding in the rest of the world, I think India is emerging as an island of stability and growth. India has, in a way, now found growth rates, green shoots emerging everywhere. As far as the inflation is concerned, it's not too much out of the way. It is closer to the band. As far as WPI is concerned, it is now single digit. And therefore, my recommendation would be that the RBI should not be aggressive in pushing the repo rate too much. Yeah, yeah. My suggestion would be, if ever we either do a pause button, and if ever we want to, as mentioned, that we need to catch up with the maybe a 25 basis point should be at the outer. My preference would be holding it at pause button in December. With this, I'll invite now.
तो मैं क्या कर रहा हूँ व्हाट इज दैट इन माय माइंड इज दैट
आशुतोष सर आई वांट टू यूज रिक्वेस्ट टू प्लीज अनम्यूट
योर माइक आई एम रिक्वेस्टिंग एवरीबॉडी टू प्लीज पुट देयर माइक्स आई वांट
बी डूइंग एनी पीपल विवेक विवेक आशुतोष मिश्रा अनम्यूट मिस्टर आशुतोष मिश्रा
टू गिव अ लिटिल बिट ऑफ अ कॉन्फिडेंस अबाउट द रिस्क मैनेजमेंट ओनली सो दैट्स व्हाट आई थिंक वी आर डूइंग एनफ पीपीटीज ऑल द टाइम सो एंड आई विल नॉट बी डूइंग एनी पीपीटी
If there's a demand, then we will send the PPT by mail to them if anything is there.
Mr. Ashutosh.
Something ready made, I mean, that can be shared.
We can, because there are some now who just mugs up things and.
Mr. Ashutosh, if you could simply please.
Charan sir, please go ahead, sir.
He called me in the morning and told me. But let me see if he's there. Otherwise, I know his view. I can read it out from there. Indraneel, would you be able to articulate your thoughts? Okay, let me read it to you. Indraneel was down with flu and therefore couldn't speak. But he has sent me his written views. Let me read it to you. He's suggesting a 35 basis rate hike. And he's recommending that Fed is likely to raise by 50 basis point in December. So to that extent, he is moderating and he's taking into a factoring in that Fed may not go for 75 basis point, but moderates it, and so would RBI. Indraneel also is of the view that inflation has peaked and the RBI has hit zero real rate on the fiscal year 2020-23. Inflation basis. There is no doubt that the RBI will need to try to limit the differential with the Fed to 150 plus basis point, a point which Indraneel has been making even earlier. Indraneel also sees that the Fed will be rising to 5.25% by May. This will likely force the RBI to raise to 6.75%. And then a cut may come in 2024. Indraneel also sees and recommends a 1% CRR cut to raise deposits to meet high loan demand as OMO is difficult after the rally in G-Secs. So in a nutshell, Indraneel is recommending a 35 basis point hike immediately in December. And he feels that this may go up to 6.75% by May. With this, let me now invite our next colleague and panelist, Mr. Abhik Barua, to share his thoughts with us.
Dr. Singh, and thank you for having me. I'm going to be very brief in the interest of time. I think we have a hard stop at 1:30. I would broadly echo what Indraneel has recommended, although in terms of the rationale for continuing to raise rates and possibly taking it to 6.5 to 6.75, there is also the issue of elevated and very sticky core inflation, which I think should bother us. I think it is hurting affordability. it typically tends to increase inequality, and we know that growth is uneven. So that's one battle that is far from being won, and I think the RBI needs to keep at it. I would completely agree with Indraneel that liquidity manifested in the huge disconnect or the wedge between deposit and credit growth is becoming a big challenge for banks. This is the way how tight monetary policy works. It it brings about an increase in the credit deposit ratio. It then necessitates an increase in deposit rates and loan rates, and that's how things cool off. So I see it very much as a part of the way that monetary policy operates. But it is possible that there is, it is a little overdone and the system is way too stretched, for which some amount of liquidity infusion is needed. I would see the optics of a CRR cut just as problematic in terms with the RBI's stance, which is still sort of primarily battling inflation, which is above its target range, just as problematic as doing an open market operation. So one has to sort of get the narrative right, and one really doesn't know whether, open market operations in the secondary market, which are far less noticed or far less sort of headline making, are a better way forward. I would recommend a 35 basis point increase in the next policy. And as I said, the terminal rate should be 6.5 to 6.75. I'm on the same page as Indraneel and see the Fed carrying on and looking at, five quarter, although the quantum of rate increases, I think we are past the heavy duty 75 basis point increases. The next one is going to be 50, and then let's see how it goes forward. And I think let's also not get, also remember some of the risks that are there in the system, instead of focusing too much on immediate data, which is certainly encouraging. But I think this entire export piece, the possibility of that problem intensifying going forward as the global economy slows down, that remains a concern. I think uneven recovery, which a lot of people have commented on, has issues of associated of whether it is sustainable or not, because if the top tiers are funding all the demand and the bottom tiers are being left behind, and that certainly is a problem. So the economy is in good shape now, but let us not forget the headwinds. So again, just to sort of re-emphasize my recommendation, 35 basis point increase in the next policy. I find this idea of withdrawal of accommodation a very inarticulate description of the stance. I think they should either say neutral or contractionary, and we are sort of virtually at a neutral level, if not contractionary. So I would expect some clarity there. But I think for us in the banking community, and should it be for industry, liquidity, I think, is the big issue going forward. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Abhik, thank you very much. Even I was thinking between the stats, should they bring it to neutral or should they be explicit now and say contractionary, or do they want to continue? I totally agree with you. They need to clarify. I also agree with you. Yes, the headwinds have to be kept in mind. So thank you for your observation.
Sure, my pleasure.
Let me now invite Madam Upasana. She is the chief economist at Kotak Mahindra.
Thank you, Dr. Singh. I would just draw upon some of the points which Abhik was referring to. I think one, to begin with, yes, I too recommend a 35 basis of repo rate hike. It should be in sync with what we've just discussed, what Dr. Singh mentioned and what Abhik did say. Basically, growth is quite resilient. That is on the surface. Of course, the risk which Abhik highlighted, I'll just come back to that in a bit. But so growth seems to be resilient. If we were to look at what RBI has in its hand from the last two inflation readings, we had a 7.4% and then we had a 6.8%. So inflation seems to have peaked out for sure. But if we were to look at the internals, then the 6.8% was only drawn by favorable base effect. The food inflation has been quite ugly and core inflation remains sticky, nothing to be comforted about. Even as we go ahead, I think core inflation will remain a challenge. So that's one big risk which we have, because now bulk of the onus of moderating inflation is going to be on favorable base effect, and hopefully food prices will behave themselves. I mean, that's where everyone is hopeful about, because core inflation is seemingly very sticky and we don't see much correction there. And actually, if we look at how food inflation has behaved in the last few quarters, it's been quite, it hasn't really been pleasing at all. So we are seeing some early signs of moderation. Some positive vibes are coming. The Rabi sowing has been robust. So hopefully the wheat production is going to be much better into the coming season. There are some positive signs coming through, but nonetheless, I think there are risks to the inflation story. So, another important aspect to keep in mind is that we are talking about inflation coming down below 6% by March, probably, and because of favorable base effect and all, we will see a much more benign trajectory into next year. But having said that, we don't see sustainability of inflation around 4%. So once RBI has achieved a 6% target or sub 6% target, the next goalpost is going to shift to a 4%. So to expect any possibility of monetary policy easing, even into FY24, whether it is towards the middle of year or the next, so the latter part of the year, I don't see that happen at all. In the near term, inflation remains a challenge, and hence I think 35 basis is a given, of course, but beyond that, another 25 basis, and probably, you know, if you just look at the rate cutting cycle, which started in February 2019, we started with a 6.5% peak in repo rate. I think we'll probably go back there, which means 35 and then a 25 basis of a rate hike. We stop there at 6.5%, but then it plateaus out there for a long period of time. I don't see a rate cut possibility anywhere towards FY24 at all. In that context, I think the Fed rate hike becomes important because, you know, even though the Fed chair has sounded dovish, but they have tried to up their stance on the fact that much more needs to be done. And in that context, a 5 or a 5.25, and then also if it's a shallow recession in the US, then I don't necessarily see a rate cut, you know, happening towards the end of 2023 as well there. Even if it happens, it will be just absolutely at the, you know, exit of 2023, which means that the interest rate differential also has to be maintained, and hence the possibility of any rate cuts could not be, I mean, we should not look at a possibility, let's put it like that, from India's monetary policy side as well. Growth, I do remain concerned on the K-shaped recovery. Maybe Siddharth will be in a position to give a little more details on that, but we are seeing some areas of concern there. We are seeing that, you know, most of the FMCG clients that we speak to, they are seemingly concerned about the volumes growth, the growth that they are witnessing in the lower segment, lower pockets of the curve. And that remains a point of worry. We are also, you know, we did this survey of about 900 clients of ours. There also a very, very distinct clarity came about, wherein this MSME clients seem to be extremely concerned about sustainability of demand. The export growth slowdown is already weighing on them. And hence, any plans of private capex expansion is being shelved off completely. So there is a clear distinction that we're seeing that in the larger corporates, there are plans which are still holding on, the capex or the private investment that we talk about, but the lower or the smaller companies, they still remain under stress and they don't seem to be talking about any possibility, especially given that the capacity utilizations across the board, what we saw was above 80%. So despite capacity utilization rates being so high, most of the MSME clients are not looking at any expansion in the foreseeable future. So I think that is one place where we need to worry about, because they tend to be very labor intensive, and they do have very strong interlinkages with the rest of the economy. So that will have a bearing on growth going ahead. So external headwinds, global headwinds will weigh on India's GDP next year as well. But nonetheless, if we were to compare to the rest of the world, then India would still be outshining, I think. So we are looking at 6.8% GDP growth for this year, lower than what RBI is saying. RBI is at 7%. And for next year, we are at 6% GDP growth. I think inflation is a given. I don't see any changes by RBI to either their GDP or inflation forecast. So 6.7% average for this year, which will moderate to 5.2-5.3% next year. But having said all of this, I think you were referring, Dr. Singh, to the stance of RBI. I think, you know, RBI governor did mention about a possibility once they reach a real rate closer to the 2019 levels in the previous conference. And the way I look at this is that by the time we approach February policy, the chances of the shift. So I agree with Abhik, there's no point in discussing about the stance, but the fact is RBI in their statement has to mention that at some point that the withdrawal of accommodation has to move towards a neutral in writing. And that statement will probably change once there is going to be a much you know, more positive. Right now we are at the margin, the real rates are at the margin. Positive. I think by the time in the next 2 months, we would see about 1.5% positive real rates. And even deposit rates have started turning positive. I think that's a positive sign. And with some more substantial evidence there, by February, we should move into the neutral stance. I think that's about from my end for now.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. One thing which comes to my mind, thanks for articulating very well on the stance thing. And also, I agree with you. We'll have to be really careful in what's happening if the core inflation is sticky. And that if that is not moving, then where are we? So I totally agree with your assessment. One thought that comes in my mind, and maybe I'll come back to you and a week later, and Siddharth and Arjun can take it. You know, we have always, as economists, somehow we are sticky at the 150 basis point interest rate differential. And I was wondering, in these circumstances, would a decoupling take place? And if the differential increases, would that be too harmful? I'm not very sure. But I'll come back to you and Abhik. In the meantime, let me invite Siddharth Sanyal, my colleague, and the panelist to share his views. Siddharth, this is the Bandhan Bank, please.
Sure. Thank you very much, Dr. Singh. It's always a pleasure to be on this particular panel and discuss our views. Our view will be slightly more conservative in terms of rate hikes on the part of RBI. And I think this has been a steady pattern over the course of the last several meetings also. We do think there is still strong possibility and likelihood of one more hike from the RBI in this particular policy, but we do clearly think that this should be significantly lower than in terms of clip size compared to what we have seen in the past. We need to keep in mind the roughly 50 basis point high, 40 and 350s that we have seen in the past four policies within a span of just 6 months is extremely unusual in the Indian context. Some 190 basis point hike in repo rate, as well as the significant rundown on the excess liquidity that was there in the system. I do think that was that was necessary at that point of time, given the trajectory that we had been experiencing on the inflation front. But now that systemic liquidity has come down so dramatically lower, further possibly a room for very large hike in interest rate in large cliff size might actually turn a couple beyond a point where it might start turning a little more harmful.
Requesting everybody, please mute your mics, please.
Subhash
Agarwal ji, I think your mic is on. I think one particular point I'd like to highlight in this particular cycle, we have, as we discussed, that we have hiked very significantly over the course of the last 6 months. And this is the first time in our history we are going through a hiking cycle where the relevance of the EBLR system, external benchmark linked rate system, is much more relevant in case of India. Now, in case of a large number of segments, as soon as the RBI hikes rates, so I think it for the overall asset books of the banks, it's about 40%, if not higher, that as soon as RBI hikes rates, the rate hike is transmitted to retail lending rates, etc., instantaneously and completely. So that means the 190 basis point hike has been transmitted to those loans without them even realizing within a span of 6 months. Further large hikes will possibly have a risk in terms of behavior of those retail loan segment. My sense is that there is a significant chunk of housing loan, etc., in that segment also. Interestingly, the high credit growth that we have experienced over the course of the last few months has a very significant chunk of retail lending at this moment. I'm not saying that. We need to see very closely that whether that's necessarily a very healthy practice going ahead, or at some point of time there has to be a little more handholding on the part of RBI in terms of creating awareness on the part of the banking system as a whole, especially where large quantum of loans are going to the going to retail lending, and I think that process has already started to some extent. But at this moment, if we continue hiking rates in a very in large clip size, at some point of time, we might actually invite a risk of that particular portfolio getting hurt all of a sudden. Now, one particular point in terms of the style of moves on the part of RBI has been that compared to the global rate cycle, we have moved in more moderate quantums on both sides more often than not. When during the COVID time, the cuts in case of some of the larger economies had been very, very sharp, we had front-loaded the cuts, but we possibly didn't cut as much. So at this moment also, we have the advantage, and RBI is utilizing that headroom in a very, very commendable fashion, that that we need not necessarily hike at the same pace when we have reached to our normal rate zone. While on an immediate basis, the real rate is not really significantly positive, I do expect that as inflation trajectory going ahead a couple of quarters, 3-4 quarters down the line is expected to be relatively lower, we need to take that particular factor also into account, that if with a 25 basis point hike, today our rate will go to something like 6.15, and our inflation expectations couple of quarter down the line in the 5% handle, it may not be such a bad scenario when the economy is coming out of a significant slow patch for a while. The other two factors here is that at what pace capacity expansion and capex is increasing. I think capacity expansion has shown some signs of uptick, but not really private capex still. We need to really remain very, very mindful about that particular aspect also, particularly given liquidity is also not very, very easy at this moment. We have entered the busy season at this moment, while the headline credit growth is looking robust, it's not necessarily very strong in case of private capex and project finance. So I think these factors need to be kept in mind. And I agree with Abhik when he mentions, and if I understood him correctly, that when the RBI is still hiking in at a significant pace, cutting CRR in big quantum at this moment might actually be some kind of a confusing signal. So RBI might actually be slightly more conservative in terms of cutting CRR straight away right now. But that will remain in their, that has to come on their radar at some point of time, especially towards the end of the year. And in the past, RBI has done occasionally, we have seen towards the end of financial years, they have occasionally done CRR cuts for a limited number of months or with a sunset date inbuilt in that. So this kind of options cannot really be ruled out going ahead over the course of the next one or two, one policy, in fact, or somewhere in between. But at this moment, my sense is that it's very important to move to a lower clip size of hike. So I do expect a 25 in this particular policy and potentially not too many hikes after that. So our terminal rate in this particular policy cycle on the part of RBI remains somewhere in the sub 6.5% zone. I think last one point on my part, while the GDP number had been encouraging or decent in this particular round, we need to keep in mind that the manufacturing number had been some kind of a significantly disappointing. And one last point from my side is that a very important factor, and at the cost of repetition, I have told about this particular point many a times in this particular forum, that how exactly the consumer confidence index is behaving. And there, while we have seen that the consumer confidence for the current period is steadily on an increasing path, two points to be noted. One is it's still just about the March 2020 level, which is the COVID start of the COVID period. It's just about that level and hasn't really gone past beyond that level. And also, Indian consumers' expectation typically has a bullish bias, and that is reflected always in the 1 year forward expectation. If you see 1 year forward expectation on the part of Indian consumers, and eventually what turns out to be the instantaneous expectation 1 year down the line, they typically enjoy a significant spread. So the positive expectation on the consumer confidence part is kind of structural, I would tend to say. There we have already started seeing some bit of moderation in the recent one or two readings. I think we cannot really ignore that also. So I'd stop here in the interest of time, but in case any questions, happy to take that later. Thank you.
Thank you, Sidhar. Thank you. Let's move on to Arjun Nagraj. Arjun.
Thanks a lot.
Arjun Nagarajan is the chief economist at Sundaram Mutual. So, Arjun?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Dr. Charan. Thanks a lot, ASSOCHAM, for the opportunity. I'll keep it brief for the interest of time. So, three, four quick points I'd like to make. So, one, I think the most likely scenario is a one and done from an RBI, 35 basis points of a rate hike, and the RBI should be done with that. Worst case scenario, they should stop the terminal rate, should stop at around 6.5. That was my first point. Second, on growth, I agree with my previous panelist, Ms. Upasana was talking about how she's looking at in and around 6.8. I think we are at 6.5 to 6.8% for FY23, and for 24, 6 to 6.5% for FY24. That's on growth. Inflation, no particular concerns, at least at this point, but there are upside risks on the food front, nothing that we are concerned of immediately. On the CRR front, we would think the RBI might not go for a CRR cut for two reasons. One is from a transmission point of view, the RBI has done 190 basis points. Of that, weighted average lending rates have gone up only by around 100 to 110 basis points. And after a very brief liquidity deficit, it's been sort of flip-flopping between a marginal surplus and a deficit. And if you're looking at it from a call rate point of view, the call rate that was higher than the repo rate at close to 620 has actually moved down somewhere closer to around a 575. So from a transmission point of view, I think it might be better that the call rate sticks in and around the repo. So from a CRR point of view, we would think a CRR cut at this point in time may not be appropriate from a liquidity stance and a call rate point of view. That was the first set of points. The second is from the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve, they've raised rates to nearly now 4%, so roughly around 375 basis points or so. And the RBI has delivered roughly around 50% of the Federal Reserve's rate hikes. So Indranil was talking about the rate differential between the Fed and India, he was talking about 150. So I would like to differ on that point. I feel the spread has actually narrowed too fast and too sharply as well. And given that our trade deficit run rate now is almost $23-24 billion, nearly double what it was pre-COVID in a sustainable sort of a period, the next 12 months will see currency volatility. And at that point in time, I think reducing the rate differential might not be something that India might want to do. So what possibly will help India from that standpoint is that the Fed is expected to peak at around 5 to 5.25, and the markets are pricing in rate cuts from the Fed as early as September of 2023. So the best thing for the RBI to do is to possibly hike now in December and then have an extended pause probably all through the 2023. That way, on the way down when the Fed moves, we will still sort of keep rates as at constant and sort of help the widening of the differential and to a certain extent help the rupee. So that was one point. And lastly, I think. Yeah, so lastly, I think from an RBI point of view, I think the last rate hike and done, that should sort of take care of monetary policy for the RBI, unless they want to do tweaks on the OMO fronts, given that CRR isn't an option at this point in time. So till the end of 2023, I think we should be good with one more hike. Thank you. That's it from my side. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Arjun. I would like to go back to Abhik and Upasana if they want to add something. And then I'll open up to the participants or other panelists if they want to. They have heard each other. And if they want to add something last minute, most welcome. Upasana?
Just on the interest rate differentials, I think the latter part of what Arjun said, he's kind of clarified that. And just Arjun to, I don't think Indranil was talking. In fact, he was talking the reverse. He's not kind of propagating a narrowing of interest rate differentials. That's why he's calling for, I think, 675 as a repo rate.
50 plus, right?
Yeah. So he's in fact saying that it should not go anywhere below 150, and hence there's a need for continued action. Mm-hmm. The only point here I would like to say is that because I don't see any possibility of a rate hike, rate cut, like I said, even into FY24 or maybe even FY25. But there is a possibility of a rate cut by the Fed towards the fag end of 23-24, early 24. This interest rate differentials, which have narrowed significantly, they will again stabilize at relatively better levels. And hence, the impact on currency could be managed. The second point is, going by historical standards, we cannot use the historical interest rate differentials to compare India's differentials today with the Fed, with the US, largely because then the inflation differentials also were much wider. You know, we kind of give our historical comparisons when India's inflation sustainably used to be in double digits, 2013 and before. While today the situation is very different, we have India's inflation. I mean, if I was to talk about today, that 6.8 versus 7.7% US inflation. So, you know, it's the situation is reverse. So using historical standards to compare the interest rate differentials is also not entirely right. real rates is probably the right way to look at. And secondly, I would also like to highlight one more point that, you know, when the foreign investors, when we talk about interest rate differentials, we talk about the debt investors. In theory, this is right, but in practice, they are more concerned about how rupee will be behaving. And if that is seemingly stable and well managed, flows will still come. So it is not just about narrowing of interest rate differentials. Theoretically, that is the sound argument. But when you look at practical inflows or outflows, it is normally a take on how the currency is going to behave. And if RBI will be able to manage the currency in a stable range, I think flows could still come about next year. It will be better than this year. Let's put it like that. Because this year, debt has not really got any flows.
Okay. I think I tend to agree with you. Indraneel probably was recommending 150 plus and limit it around that. So you are right in that interpretation. But I agree with you. There could be more than just the interest rate differential.
Let me, Dr. Singh, if I may, I think Upasana raised a very, very, very critical point, an extremely critical point. And if you just look at the academic literature, including Dr. Virmani's papers on capital flows, they are related to differences in real interest rates. And that factors in this inflation issue, and if there is inflation, there is a possibility of exchange rate correction for for the trade account. So I think just looking at nominal interest rate differentials is not correct, and hence you will have historically much higher spreads. But they are, as Upasana very, very lucidly put it, they are reflective of much higher inflation differential. So I think real interest rates are the right metric. Any paper, any analysis that you see, be it the IMF, be it whoever, be it the sort of the academic journals, be it Dr. Virmani, it's always real interest rates. So I think we need to just focus and sort of take that into consideration a little more.
Abhik, I totally agree with you. Last time also, Dr. Virmani, and even earlier, he has been hovering around the real interest rate and the mentioning about the RBI study where he said the real interest rate 0.75. And that is where he looked at. So I agree with you. And thanks to Upasana for flagging it and bringing it back to on the table. Any more observations from you, Siddharth or Arjun?
No, nothing in particular. Thank you.
Arjun, anything you want to add?
No, nothing from my side.
Nothing. Okay. So my suggestion is we have hit the 1:30, and I think 1 hour discussion is really a rich discussion on the interest rates. There are a few questions here as I see in the chat box, but can we take one question? I know it's the middle of the day. You people are both all from the industry, must be super busy. Can I take just one question, or you think we can close? I don't know if
how many questions do you have, Dr. Chandra?
There are a couple, but I'm going to just take at least three questions. At least three. I don't know if that the time we have scheduled is this time in the middle of
I do understand, but after this, I think taking question could solve the audience purpose.
Okay, let me do one thing then.
Let me first invite
Mr. Narendra if he wants to make any observations, and then I'll go to the questions.
Yeah, thank you for all the panelists and Dr. Charan Singh, and congratulations to Charan Singh and Virmani Saab also. Both of them have really got the required placements also in a way. Sir, as all of you have mentioned, that the rate of increase in line with the Fed, the rate of increase, that may undergo some change. And as earlier, we had a higher in, now it is expected what most of the participant and the market, it may be a 35 basis. And I also agree that one side, we are still having the problem of inflation. Other side, we cannot ask for CRR cut, because the money in circulation or the money available itself leads to the inflation against the supply side bottlenecks. So I think that CRR, when the banks have excess SLR, so long as the excess SLR can be used for growth of credit. And other side also, banks should have a little more pressure to increase the deposit rate. Actually, they have been reduced or not kept the deposit rate as much increase as that required. And they are having the differential between the credit growth and deposit growth. So recently in the SBI conclave also, we asked this question. So the SBI chairman felt that for some time we don't have any liquidity problem. We are having enough SS XLR and we can manage that. And that's where there may not be any CRR cut. Second is, the one point is whether the RBI is satisfied with the inflation below 6% or they are satisfied with the inflation below 4%. Because sometime during COVID and all, the RBI, in spite of the interest inflation at 6%, went on reducing the interest rate. But I don't think that would be the case now. And the whole fight is to see that whether we can come nearer to the 4%. So in that case, the cycle of interest rate, the amount of increase may vary. And until Fed also reaches this target, in Indian context, that will continue, but mindful of the growth. So the growth also is one of the issue, and which now we see that it is likely to show some slowness, and there may be RBI also getting the revised the GDP growth as against 7%. They may even go for slightly lower, and some of the changes are coming from the other analysts also. So these are all the situations, sir, that we continue definitely agree with the panelist view, and I am only thing that RBI should aim at 4% inflation target, even though there is a 200 basis this side, that side, because the pain at the bottom of the pyramid and pain at the common man is still higher, and unless that pain is taken out, we will not have a consumption, because for our Indian context, we need a consumption, we need a higher GDP growth, and we need a per capita income more, and people need to save as well as spend. So I think to that extent, RBI will also aim at that their inflation targets. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. I just want to explore if Dr. Ashok Vishandas has a question. Is my colleague and founder director at eGrow, Dr. Ashok Vishandas. Okay, no. Then I'll go to Mr. Deepak Agarwal ji. My request to you is, I've read your questions, quite a few of them. Can you just briefly ask one question? Because as I mentioned, we scheduled this in the middle of the day and the panelists have to rush back because they're in the middle of the day. So can you kindly ask one pointed question and I can see if the panelists are available and they can attempt to answer?
Thank you, eGrow and Associate, for this opportunity. As I mentioned, like, I want the reduction in repo rate. Why? Because we are on the cusp of a new growth cycle where we are having the G20 presidency in hand, where we are talking about PLI, we are talking about FTA norms. So how we gain those kind of competitive advantage? Because if we are talking about treasury gains only, not about the trade and services, which is cost effectiveness. So only the bank can provide that kind of support with the kind of monetary policy support. So when the cost of capital is lower, we can have higher growth in those terms, because the industry is facing a backlash of last 2-3 years of pandemic blues. So they need to revive, survive and thrive. So they need capital and at the very bottom of the cost, because if you see nearby countries, they are very cost competitive in terms of banking, like capital. So we need to have an ecosystem balancing act where monetary policy is supporting those ecosystem survival. So I want to understand how I think I had the opportunity last time also to discuss on this, like Mr. Arvind Vinwarni clearly told, like real interest rate is a moot point right now, but we need to think over it. So I think this is the right time to think over this real interest and the real growth cycle rate. So this is my point. So can we discuss on that? Can we have a viewpoint on this?
Thank you very much, Deepak Agarwalji. Means, okay, I don't know, Siddharth or Arjun, do you want to briefly and focused response to this? I know a discussion would not be possible. It'll be too lengthy, but we are at 1:38. Yeah. So would you like to have a brief response to this? First Siddharth, then we can go to Arjun.
Sure. So I think this is a very valid point in a way, and in one way it's actually echoing with one particular theme that's coming up today compared to some of the other rounds a few months back, that now we need to switch gear to a more nuanced and more balanced approach, as a significant part of tightening has already been delivered in a multi-pronged way. So happy to see that particular point is coming from even beyond the panel.
Arjun, you want to supplement or make any observation?
Yes, doctor. So a couple of things. One is, normally you have around a 3-quarter lag for monetary policy to start taking effect. And December to March 2023 will be these 4 months where you will be seeing softer data points across the world, and given that we've been tagging the Fed across emerging markets as well. So from a rates point of view, and we've been raising rates, though the RBI says it's largely from a point of view of inflation, we've not really had an inflation problem like the West. So our rate rises have actually been more to keep the lid on the currency to a large extent. So from a RBI point of view, I think we think it's going to be one and done for, I think, till the most of 2023. So there shouldn't really be more hikes going forward, given that only 50% of transmission has also happened of the RBI hikes. That would be it from my side.
Mr. Deepak Agarwal, my own personal view is quite in sync with the observations made, but my personal view is that by not hiking and letting the country move with inflation where it is, I would have in 2 or 3 cycles achieved that objective which you are referring to. On the other hand, if I reduce it right now, it will be very confusing for both the global markets looking at India and the domestic observers working in India. So that is why I would say a moderate approach would be not to hike it or slow down the hike to 25 basis points. So you clearly tell them that, look, the incremental hike is being slowed down and you achieve the same objective. Something which Upasana was making, I think, a valid point, that cap expenditure is not taking place. That's the point even Mr. Siddharth made. So therefore, to somehow kickstart the economy, and if the green shoots have to be sustained, you need to do something. So that is where I would say either stop it totally and say I've paused and I'm waiting, or reduce it to 25 basis point in this cycle and then don't hike it in the next cycle. Yes. So there is a consistency and a glide path that will emerge, which will be more stable. With this, let me thank each one of you to enrich this discussion today. We have tried a very different time slot this time, middle of the day, and I think you would have all benefited from it. Probably next time we'll think through the pros and cons of middle of the day or the end of the day. I want to thank ASSOCHAM, Dr. Rajesh, for having put all this together, Mr. Agarwal for being with us and always representing the industry's view and sharing with us so articulate he is as to what the industry wants from us or from the RBI, and bringing the industry viewpoints onto the shadow. I must thank each one of you for being with us and participating and enriching this discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Well done, sir. Thank you so much. Well done.
Okay, thank you.